was forever changed when the digital frontier opened for the first time. In celebration of this groundbreaking film, D23 Expo is proud to present Back to the Grid, 40 Years of Tron, presented by Enterprise. To take us on this digital journey, please welcome your hosts, Juju Green and Mike Bonifer, to the stage.
Gear. Somebody gave me some Tron glasses.
What you got?
But you can't see anything, but they're perfect as headgear. So I'm gonna use
them.
Is this okay?
No,
it's okay. Okay, good. But you know what? You love to wear memorabilia.
I
heard that. We heard the rumors. So Donald Kushner, the producer of Tron, is gonna come out here with a one of a kind piece of memorabilia. Donald. Come on, yeah, Donald Kushner.
Woo! Oh my gosh!
One of a kind.
Woo!
You have to make a ritual of this. You have to make a ritual. Help him put it on.
Woo!
I feel like I'm being.
King Charlie has nothing on this. There we go. Okay. We'll see you later in the show. So let's bring out the first group. We're going to work in two groups today. The first part will be the visual effects designers of the film. Let's bring out Richard Taylor, visual effects supervisor and also one of the key artistic influences of the film, designer Richard Taylor. Supervisor who solved an incredible number of problems in the production, was the go-to person in so many ways, John Sheely. And finally, one of the unsung heroes of the production, an animation camera person, and we're going to get into how heroic the animation effects were on this film, Glenn Campbell, our Glenn Campbell. So, let's get the presentation started. Juju.
I'm pretty sure you guys want to know everything too, right? Like, yeah. And I think what we should get into first is this awesome 40th anniversary poster, right? This poster is really, really rad. The design, Richard, your design is absolutely fantastic. Can you like talk about what went into the thinking of this? Because I'm pretty sure this is a monumentous occasion to create something new for something.
The poster?
Yes.
Well, yes, I'm very fortunate, first of all, to be here and to have been associated with Tron, which is truly a unique moment in the history of film, in the history of communications. And luckily, I was one of the four designers, Sid Mead, Jean-Claude Modius, Peter Lloyd, and myself did the majority of the design work on the film. And one of my jobs was to do a lot of, first of all, you got to remember, 1982, 40 years ago, was an amazing year for the history of film, especially special effects, Blade Runner, Poltergeist, E.T., Das Boot, Dark Crystal, the second Star Trek picture, The Thing, Firefox, all those films, and Tron. Came out in 1982, and Tron was the firewall between analog filmmaking and digital filmmaking. It was the first film to really use computer simulation to replace what would have been done with miniatures in Star Wars or Star Trek or anything else. We made computer simulated models of the tanks, you know, the solar sailor, the recognizers, all of the craft. We also were able to do camera movement and things that had never been done before with physical models. Computer simulation, we were lucky enough to introduce it to the world, and it was the first film where the computer simulation occupied, you know, 20 minutes of the film, and it was full screen negative. It wasn't on a monitor or something like that. So I think more than anything, Tron, its design, its style, is what has made it endure. It's the look of the film. Yeah. And we were the first people to get to, luckily, we got to design cyberspace. There had never been a film in cyberspace. Outer space, yes. Inner space, and you know, Elizabethan times, or the other fantasy environments, but we got to create, you know, what it looked like in the game world cyberspace. One of the things I think that people don't realize is just how handmade Tron was. And Mr. Campbell here is a testament to that. I mean, for a single character to stand there on screen, for Jeff Bridges or Bruce to be a character. By the way, we're lucky enough to have here today Mr. David Fleming in one of his Tron costumes.
This is actually better.
Well, we had to make them by hand, but David used the latest technology. But he'll be around all day. You should talk to him, take a look at it, because we shot those kind of costumes on black sets and turned those black lines into glowing light. And it took 5 exposures for a character to stand there in a frame. And sometimes we would do 25, 30, 40 exposures per frame because the backgrounds were animating. When you look at a sequence like the Crystal Cave, incredible. Talk about amazing design.
Okay, so I want to interject something here because we're getting into the design of it, but I want to know from Harrison, what did you tell people you were making? Because this had never been done before. So how did you describe this project to people?
I think the person who described it best was Mr. Taylor when he said, "This is the film that's gonna melt the Naga hide off the Lazy Boys of the film."
I'll use that from now on.
Well, it was, let's face it, it was so overwhelming that when it was proposed, and I happened to be at the studio working on another movie, and so I was at the right place at the right time. And I remember Tom Wilhite, who was head of production, came in with Steven Lisberger and said, "You have to meet this guy. He's going to do Tron." And I thought, okay, sure, why not? And then he began to speak in a language I had no idea what he was talking about. Something about backlight compositing and cell flopping. And I was so naive, even though I worked on some pretty major films, but I thought cell flopping meant you put the cell down and then you flop it. And then you shoot it again. Why? I literally did not know, but I was taught early on, if you're offered a job, always say yes. Never admit that you don't know what the hell you're doing, because most likely you're not the only one. And this was such a learning experience. We went through so many different versions of how will we do it? Should we do it this way? Should we do it this? I even made up a kind of a little how to. We're going to shoot it against blue screen, of course. Yeah, why not? Well, no, that didn't work. Everything didn't work, but then it all kind of came together out of desperation, and I think that's what I learned, that Tron had a life of its own, and it couldn't be denied, because, and it was up to us to shepherd all of us, to shepherd this thing and make it work. And I tell you, there were a lot of sleepless nights. And there was a lot of, you know, okay. At one point, I'll tell this quick story, then I'll stop. We had so much work to do with the cells and the different exposures on this codeless 16 by 20 codeless animation cells, basically, but they were film. And I remember we all got together, and I think it was everybody up here, and we said, how are we gonna do this? And we spent the morning coming up with different ways. And one of my genius suggestions is that, well, we'll need, 30, 40, 50 people. We'll bring them, we'll go out to high schools and colleges, and we'll pay them a pittance, and they'll come in and they'll do the whole thing, write up the exposure sheets, we'll tell them what an exposure sheet is, and then somebody said, can they go to the bathroom? So I said, okay, yeah, well, they're gonna get hungry. How are we gonna feed them? Well, they can bring their own damn lunch. And it, eventually, it all just kind of fell apart. And we realized it was just, it was dumb.
Okay, I gotta ask, because I really love hearing the story of just the behind the scenes and making this. So you guys have crafted an entire world that has never been done, that has never been seen before, in a way that has never been done before, right? And you touched on this a little bit, but I want to talk about just, was there any moments where you felt the pressure was on? If this doesn't work, you know, not only do we have to explain it, we have to execute this. And what you're saying right now sounds insane, and I can tell you see it in your eyes. And I want to know, like, what are those moments that made you go, could we pull this off?
Well, first of all, I want to say the whole project, it all exists because of Steven Lisberger. We have to give him a clue. The man is a genius, and the concept was brilliant, and Donald, and he, the fact that they were able to convince the studio to do the picture was truly amazing in that time. But going back to your question, there were moments along the way. We had to put together a trailer for NASA, which is the National Association of Theater, or NATO, National Association of Theater Owners, which was in Vegas, and we had to take an example of what the film was gonna look like. All studios do, and that's when the theater chains make a decision what films are gonna, you know, they're gonna carry for that summer, that year. So we had to get that done, and we had to push all the processes through and make them work the first time. And for those of you who are not familiar, computer simulation was, as I mentioned, featured in Tron. But the other part was the fact that the way we processed the live action footage of characters in costume, like the one David's wearing, to turn those into glowing characters and to make the backgrounds. And I've got to say, one of the most amazing things in the film that was done well, that we had to test at that point, is the effects animation, which was done every streak of a disc, every explosion. Yeah, they were all of that was hand-drawn with airbrush grads and backlit. You know, John Shealy there is holding up.
This is one of the cells.
That's a cell right there.
Wow.
John, use your mic and tell us some of the problems that Richard and Harrison saddled you and Glenn with that you had to figure out.
Wow.
Are those original cells?
I had been doing backlit techniques at Robert Abel Associates, and we rolled those techniques into Tron.
Yeah, I think that the thing that Richard's referring to, we all thought when we were making the film, well, it wasn't going to become an interpretive dance piece. It was going to be a movie. That was my idea. We all thought we could do digital characters very imminently. Richard had an awesome test of a juggler that became the logo of ILM, but live action was nowhere near happening in CGI for human characters. And Bruce Logan shot this beautifully fine-grained, large format 65 film, enlarged out onto 12 and a half by 20 Codalists, just gorgeous. And Disney had the experience. Harrison brought that to the picture, the legacy of the studio, of being able to composite live action into animation, going back to many number of films of Mary Poppins, the Pete's Dragon shortly before us, but they had the tools for this and the technology established in the traditional means of photographic compositing. And Glenn and I worked on the animation stands and compositing that and coming up with the approach to it. And yes, Gigi, we had to ramp up like crazy several times, just ramp up. Yeah. And Richard brought together brilliant teams from outside. Harrison had astonishingly capable, experienced teams at Disney. It was a real merger of an old and new team. And it felt to me then like AI feels now. You know, we were on fire with what we were doing, and it wasn't just problems. We knew those problems.
We knew we were inventing what we were doing as we went along, and that was the thrill of it.
That's the cool part.
But the Glenn down there was our premier animation cameraman, and to understand those cells that John held up, each one of those went on a light box with registration pins, and there were 18 animation cameras in all, and every frame, 24 frames a second, had to be exposed to film, no digital. Every frame of Tron was shot on film, including the computer simulation, where film was looking at a high-resolution monitor. But Glenn, as an animation camera man, had to change exposures, filters, artwork, all of these different steps per frame for, you know, my God.
82 was the highest number.
82 passes.
Yeah, 82 passes. The shot where Sark walks into the control room and plugs himself in and the MCP shows up. That one shot, walks in, plugs in, MPC. It took a week to shoot, 82 passes, and it was literally running 24/7. The ship would come in, where are you? I'm on frame 32. Okay, pick up. The scariest was frame pass 82. So please don't let me be the one to mess up.
Week. Well, that's the thing about making the film. I mean, we basically, it was a one-off, handmade. No film ever looked like that again. If you look at frames from all the films that were made that year that I mentioned on a light table, they're all noir. They're all dark green and gray and blue, and then there's this fluorescent glowing frame that's drawn because it was truly a unique piece of art.
Can I ask a little bit about what you're talking about with the framing and the colors and everything? Because looking at that cell, it looks like a painting. And the thing that strikes me most about the painting, with all the technological aspects that go into it, it's the character that still is like out of focus. It's easy to get lost into the sauce of, you know, all the lights and everything. But can we talk a little bit more about some of the costume designs of that the characters are wearing and how you apply that to those characters?
Well, one of the most important things that you just mentioned was when Steven first brought the project to us, the characters in the electronic world were all going to be animated, stylized characters, backlit, so they did glow. But I felt, and Steven agreed, that we really needed to use the actors, because the bottom line in any storytelling is the human being and the heart. And to not have those characters speaking to us and being themselves in the electronic world, so we had to come up with a way to do that. And that was the hardest thing. And luckily Kodak worked with us, and we were lucky enough to recruit some people that I had worked with at Abel's to be scene coordinators. And they wrote those exposure sheets and laid all that artwork out.
Well, and Richard, on the set, I think there's some pictures coming up, but the costumes were essentially hand done, stenciled patterns. But Richard was out there and taught the makeup effects people how to apply the chart pack graphics tape, how to fix the helmets.
Well, the helmets, awesome. One David's wearing.
Show it off, David. Show it off.
There we are.
That's made from a hockey helmet, and we applied foam and other things to them. And his costume, the shoulder pads were from motocross gear, but we made them by hand. And each one of those helmets, we were less than 2 weeks away from principal photography, and we had white helmets. So I took one home every night, and was using masking tape and chart pack tape and some press-on type, I created a helmet a night.
I'd like to point out one thing while he's still standing up. Do me a favor, turn around and face us, I need you to look at his black and white costume, and forgive me for this, but it'll make sense later. Please look at his butt. I will explain.
We were doing that anyhow. Yeah, this one, all of us backstage.
So you called those butt grabs, right? There's actually a name.
There's a name for it. Could you hold these up? So the entire movie was shot guys on black sets wearing their black and white suits, which is the first pass. That was shot on 70mm film. Then it was re-photographed by Bernie and the guys. They re-photographed every frame onto this. Then that was re-photographed and turned into this, which is black and white. Now notice, the suit is now black. The black lines are now white. So that means if we backlit it, we could put light through those white lines and make the lines glow on the suit. That's how we did it.
But
that means.
And one of the things we had to do was make the white of the eyes and the white of the teeth.
Everything had to be separated. So that means when we're shooting the backlight on it, all the black lines now glow. As you noticed, he had a big concentration of black lines on his rear, which every time Tron said, "I want to walk over here," he would turn around and his butt would glow. So we're looking at dailies going, uh-oh. And they hired guys that were doing the airbrushing for the killer frisbees.
Butt specialists.
And we had a term we called butt grabs. They had to do airbrushing. So every shot, every frame, when Tron walked away from camera, a guy named Bill Arance would take an airbrush and next frame, he would do butt grabs.
Animating butt grabs. Each frame, and theoretically it never should have worked, but that's the way it was.
They have their own union.
So we have time for one more. It's a significant question, so we wanted to give this a chance to breathe. The visual effects industry, so this ignored this film, the Academy.
Yep.
Explain, please, because this film changed the course of the film industry.
I'm agree with it's always getting ignored.
Yeah, so explain, please.
Yes, so the process by which films are nominated for Academy Award by the Academy is that the films that are being considered all go to the Academy Theater, and 10 minutes of the film are cut together, and then a spokesperson stands up and answers questions from the audience, and in that audience are 40 people from the Academy who eventually vote and narrow it down to the three finalists. Well, and that's process called a bake-off. I was the spokesperson for Tron, and when all the other films were shown, the questions from the audience were those quarter-scale models, or those explosions, was that 300 frames per second? How many matte paintings did you do? They were all questions from knowledge. When I got up to answer the questions for Tron, no one raised their hand. And I was shocked, and I finally said, there must be a question. Finally, someone raised their hand and said, "What kind of camera did you use?" "Oh, we used that new Martian camera that's we imported from outer space." You know, I explained that we shot it in 70, and we had multiple animation cameras and photo rotor machines, and altogether about 25 cameras. And then, no more questions. Finally, somebody raised their hand and said, "Did you make any models?" I said, "Yes, we did. We made study models because we had to make physical set pieces covered in black to match some of the background, for example, the bridge of the Solar Sailor." So they were self-matting. And so I said, "We made study models, but we made the models in the movie." There were two different major computer animation companies. Magi Synthvision from Elmsford, New York, and Information International Incorporated here in Los Angeles. Information International made polygonal models, and Magi Synthvision made their models by what we call bullion modeling, where you're
at. All right, wait, use the bullion word. We gotta move on.
Oh, sorry about
that's
that.
That's okay, use the bullion. Harrison.
So the add and subtract.
Well, was that log or linear?
So, hang on. Was it raster graphics or vector graphics? So this is where I get lost. Wait a second.
This is what the Academy was feeling when they were explaining the
I'm representing the audience here. I just got lost. So I'm representing the Academy. Wait, I want to say something. Special Achievement Academy Award for Tron. Let's hear it. Deserves it.
So we were asked two questions, and I went backstage, and I felt this hostility from the audience. And my good friend Richard Edlund, who 5 Academy Awards for special effects, I said, "Richard, what the hell's going on? It was so weird." And he said, "Well, I think they think you cheated." And I said, "Well, what do you mean by that?" And he said, "I think they think the computer literally did it all." Oh, you type out on a keyboard, "I want a model that looks like it was made by Sid Mead traveling left to right in a frame."
So we have time just to get a comment from everybody else here. What has the credit of having worked on Tron, being a key person on the creation of this film, has it meant to you in the context of your career? Harrison, John, Glenn, just give us a take on that.
What was the question? So first you take the backlight. It was so unique, it was so crazy, and it just kind of willed itself into being. And I wasn't surprised when the Academy didn't acknowledge it, because the Academy in those days was basically white, old, some things never change. And these guys, you know, had worked on movies that were done this way. And they were just stunned. They didn't know what to think about it. And I can't blame them. It was revolutionary, it was crazy. And they hated it. It's like, what is this?
People hate brand new.
Yeah.
Especially if you do it at a high level.
And they're all so young. All the people who worked on it.
Look at that picture on the screen there.
Yeah.
That's us
in
the day.
As the publicist on the film, you're trying to get people to strike a pose. This is the crew picture. And you got one guy up there going, "I'm going to pick
that." Yeah, that's him.
This was my
And people say, "Well, back in those days, it was a man's world." Well, look at the number of women that were on the table.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
If you could do it, yeah, you're hired.
Well, and to Mike's question, Harrison, the thing is, we did everything that worked. You know, we put everything together, we solved the problems, as Richard said, by hand. It was using early CGI. It was a little bit, like I say, like AI creeping up, but boy, it was so slow and hard to do 40 hours sometimes to create one frame for a background. The technology was slow, but it was the beginning of cobbling together CGI in a meaningful way. It took off from there. But I think, for me going forward, it was the part that we just made everything work. Whatever you needed to do, you moved on and found a solution for it, as everybody does in their life with everything. So it was loads of fun to do. It was not a drag at all.
We failed so many times. Go home and go, "Oh, God, what have we gotten ourselves into?" But
that's what greatness feels like.
That's where I came in. I got a call from a friend of mine from Disney, and he said, "Hey, we got this new project coming up." "Ooh, Disney, oh boy, I'm thinking Mary Poppins." He said, "What's it called?" He said, "Tron." I'm in. Literally, he said Tron, and I thought, that stands for electronic, which means they're using CGI. It's Disney. I'm in. Literally, one phone call, one word, I was on board. Mm-hmm. So now I'm on it. We're doing all this stuff, and now we're working late night. And as I said, 40 passes, 80 passes. I was night shift supervisor, and everybody here, as you said, what have I gotten myself into? Everybody learned very quickly. I had no problem at calling at 3 in the morning going, "I'm on pass 37, I don't understand this." So everybody learned, take your count sheets home, because you're going to get a call.
Thank you all for coming. Okay,
this place? It's terrible.
It's my quarters. Not like home, is it? We can talk here. And watch this. How's that?
This is beautiful. Who let you do this?
Nobody. It's very illegal. I can only keep it this way a short time before they catch me.
Always count on you, Kelly.
Always.
Are you sure we're safe here?
For a while.
As he would walk in to do scenes. But before that, let's start at the beginning with Donald. Yep. How did you convince Disney to do a film using computers to make the animation when you're in the world center of hand-drawn animation and all of that legacy? How did you sell Disney on doing this movie?
Well, at the time they had just released a movie called The Black Hole.
Close to your mouth.
You got a black hole fan.
They just released a movie called The Black Hole, which was kind of Star Wars. And they had a new executive there, Tom Wilhite. And he was looking for something new and interesting. And so we had developed the script, we had the special effects, and we had some samples of computer animation. And we also had another studio that was interested, and we let him know that if he wasn't going to buy it, another studio would. So
that's awesome. That's awesome.
So a lot of studios buy stuff out of fear rather than afraid of someone else doing the movie.
Well, was there like a moment where during that conversation, they were just kind of, once you told them, hey, buy it or somebody else, well, did they jump on it right away, or were they just kind of like, yeah, we'll take a chance, and you said, you better take that chance.
They jumped on it right away, actually, but before they committed to production, they made us do like an effects reel or a sample reel. So they wanted to make sure what we were saying, that we knew what we were talking about, which, by the way, we didn't. I figured out if we could get the plane in the air, we'd figure out how to land it.
Sounds like you were figuring out how to build it when you got the plane in the air.
Bruce, well, how did you first get notified and cast in the film? What was that like for you?
Don, was it Pam Polifroni? Was she the casting agent back then?
Yes, right. Yes.
Well, I had done Gunsmoke and a couple other things for her. She must have submitted me or something, I don't know, but I was supposed to come in, but I was doing a television western out in Arizona, and my agent sent a script, and I'm sitting there reading this thing, and I was actually sitting on a horse, waiting for action. And I pull this thing out of the saddlebag, and I'm reading Tron. I am so far away from the Tron world in this, I'm in this old west mode, and I'm reading that. I said, I don't understand a thing that's in this loud. Anyway, no cell phones and stuff like that, so I had to wait to get back to the hotel later that night, and I called John Crosby and my agent at the time, and I asked him, and said, well, they'd like to see you. Maybe, I don't know, maybe there were things before that, but they'd like to see you. And when I got back into town, I did come out to Disney, and I think Stephen showed me some, you said you had done some footage or something, right?
Yes.
And I kind of got the idea. I said, well, it kind of looks like a Star Wars, but only you're inside of a video game. That's kind of cool. I actually was one of the 1,000 guys that went up for Luke Skywalker as well, so I said, oh, I didn't get that one. I'm very interested in this one. But I was thrilled. I had heard that Jeff Bridges was already on this thing, and I really admired, you know, you admire your peers, and I always followed his work, and I said, well, this, I'd really like to work with him. And it was very exciting when I finally kind of understood and saw it physically, and you probably know more about how I got in the damn thing than I do.
Carol, how did you, this was your first experience on a film, and did you think that every film was going to be shot in black and white on 70mm IMAX? Or?
Sure. Absolutely. It was my first, this was my first special effects movie, so it was completely different animal, you know, just in terms of how, you know, we would shoot, in, you know, this much work in a day, whereas when you do TV, you do like 8, 9, 10 pages. So, and you know, it's like, yay, we did an 8th of a page of work today! It's just like, wow, this is a whole different pace, okay. So, you know, so it's just putting all those, it's like making a quilt out of tiny pieces that you put together. So that was the thing that was really different for me, just in how slowly and how meticulously everything went together.
Yeah, if this was one of my first experiences, like in the film industry, and I worked on Tron, you couldn't tell me nothing for any other movie. I worked on this. We made it up as long as we went. But this film just, like you said, you were flying the plane and learning how to build it on the way up. There's so much things that you didn't know. You were just flying by the seat of your pants. But how do you budget for something like that? We hear about budgets all the time, but do you say, oh yeah, this in-house world that we have to build from scratch through digital animation, $5.
How we budgeted is, we kind of backed into the number. We felt that Disney had an appetite to make this film for a certain number, so that's the budget we gave them. And then, as we went on, the budget started to increase. The head of the studio at the time, his name was Ron Miller, he had married Disney's daughter.
Right.
And he was a linebacker for the Los Angeles Rams, and he was also a linebacker for USC. So on a Saturday, if USC would win and the Los Angeles Rams would win, we'd go into his office. We'd show him some slides of what the picture looked like, and it was easy to get the money out of it.
This has got to be the best, make it till you make it story ever.
It was in between him reading the sports pages of the LA Times.
I gotta say something about Ron. We used to kind of laugh about Ron during the times of Tron, but Ron treated the studio like family. And that film wouldn't have been able to run the gauntlet if it hadn't been for Ron Miller looking out for Donald, Harrison, Richard, Steven, and being in a good mood on Mondays after the Rams won. But he was forgiving in that way. We were all family. Once he committed to the film, he stuck with us. And my appreciation for Ron has only grown over the years because he was... question for Bruce. You yes. Walk onto this set, so you're out there in the Western with the cactus and the checkered tablecloths and the Conestoga wagons, and you walk onto a set and there's nothing. What are you acting with? What are you using? How does that work?
Whoa. Well, I had come from the theater, and I kind of likened it to being on a theatrical stage like this. And for the audience, oftentimes in a play, you have to create something that isn't there for them to see. That's through your acting ability. And I thought, you know, this is something which I would really have to use my imagination. Now, Stephen did have some storyboards. That was my first experience with storyboards. So, you know, Cindy and the rest of us, we could look at this thing and say, okay, we're crawling up a huge, like, pipe or something. It was actually this black platform that Cindy and I were crawling all over the place when we were being chased by the recognizers. And it was kind of, I would like it in Hollywood, silent film acting. Okay, look over your left shoulder. It's coming down closer to you. You're afraid, you know. It's over your left shoulder here. Here it is, in fact. You know, but it's weird. But we got into it. And we had a ball, you know. We were wearing these tights with motocross helmet and shoulder things and everything. And I had to train with a guy named Sam Schatz, who was a professional frisbee thrower. I had no idea there were professional frisbee throwers. Right? I mean, and there he and I, he came out and we were out in this horse corral I had at my place, and it was deep sand, so it was kind of great exercise. And he ran me through that, throwing that thing at me, dodging it, and doing all kinds of things. And I had to learn to throw a frisbee pretty well, I think.
All right, I really want everyone to understand this. So you watch all these, like, behind the scenes with the, all these actors in the green screen, and they're acting against nothing. Bruce was the first one to do it. Like, you're the first one to do it.
Yeah, it is. It is. To this day, I guess there's sort of ignorance is bliss. I had no idea what I was doing, but, you know, I just felt the whole thing. I felt like we were part of something, we were onto something new. I had never experienced this. And you just had a sense, though, that was like all pioneering efforts. Well, it may fail, but there's something. There's something about this. So as I heard Richard and Harrison and Stephen certainly explaining this and the process and the amount of lighting we had banks of lights that were so huge. Am I right, Mike?
Yeah, yeah.
I think there was a brownout in Burbank one night when we threw the switch on this thing. And
So he's getting money from the studio. Mm-hmm. He's acting in a vacuum. You, Carol, are doing what?
I'll tell you what she was doing to me. Bruce, they need you on the set. I'm not talking about later. I'm now. Get on the set now. She's always chasing after us, you know, trying to find us. You know.
So she was doing her best.
You guys would keep Jeff Bridges off the video game machines. If you remember, we had video game machines on the set. That didn't last long. Get Jeff on the set. Jeff. Where's Jeff? Anybody seen Jeff? Jeff! You know, get on set. I'm doing research.
I've Space Invaders, right?
Space Invaders.
Yes.
Taking over. No, no, no. Further
Battle Zone.
Carol,
go Battle Zone.
Battle Zone.
Battle Zone. Space Invaders.
Gallagher.
What was the? I forget.
Was it Gallagher? What's that?
Gallagher. Centipede. Centipede was a big one.
Well, it kind of distracted though, and we had, you know, we had to take those games off the sound stage because half the crew was on.
So that was your Carol Green impression, what you just did. Is so Carol, what else besides chasing after Bruce and Jeff?
Order me around.
Yeah. Well, in the order, you know, it was always fun trying to convince people before cell phones that it was really going to be a fun day to run around in tights and black velvet and not know what it is exactly. So we had, every once in a while we'd have, and it was mostly guys, so they were used to being in a position where, you know, it was the women, where this time it was mostly the guys that were, you know, in the leotards, and they didn't like it, some of them. They wouldn't, you know, some of them would say, you know, I'm not going to do this gig, sorry. And they would go home, some of the extras.
Did they go home in the tights, just all
over? Oh, no, they saw what the other people were wearing, like they'd look at Bruce and go, oh, hell no.
I thought I looked kind of good.
That's why you're strong.
I do know that we did, I think we were, Jeff and I and company, all the rest of the guys were kind of, we were in the forefront of the male thong.
Yeah, I would get phone calls from women on the lot after Bruce would walk just to the commissary, so I could almost time the rings on my phone, like, who was that guy and what was he wearing? And I wanted to meet him. So, Bruce, I booked all of those phone calls, don't worry. So we have a guest who wants to chime in here, so we're going to roll video. The guest is... visible with video, I believe. So if you want to roll video backstage.
Hi, I'm Cindy Morgan, but you probably know me as Yori from Tron. I'm so looking forward to D23. I'm very much expecting to be there, but I'm somewhere in the grid thinking about you guys. My favorite experience on Tron, the day I'll always remember, is the day I came in and Steven Litzberger, the director, said, okay, everybody, you're getting on the Silver Sailor and you're crossing the game scene. And that's when I had to say, I'm sorry, there's nothing here. And he showed me the beautiful graphics that were made up and he showed me what it would look like. So in front of me was pretty much a dining room table covered with black felt. And in front of me, I had to see something because you can't lie to the audience. So I used to be a sound engineer, and in front of me, I saw a soundboard. And that's what I used to propel the Silver Sailor forward. And as far as reality, since there was nothing there, I found the reality in the other actors' eyes. They were fantastic. I hope you have a wonderful time at D23. My heart's with you. And have a wonderful time.
Speaks to the not knowing what you're doing because it's the first time you're doing it. So I don't know what I'm acting against, but if I was an actor and I didn't know what I was doing, after every scene, because you gotta do a lot of great acting in scenes like this, end of scene I will go, acting.
It was that for sure.
After all this time, 40 years, excuse me.
50 years.
40 years in the next one.
I'll see you 10 years.
Okay.
Deal.
What memories stick with you? What has stayed with you after all this time? And what is some of your, when people ask you favorite memory from the film, what's your response to that? Carol, let's start with you on that.
Okay, I've been thinking about this one. This is a tough one. Well, for one thing, it was my very last show as a trainee, and they gave me one more day beyond that so I could finish up and not have to grovel for that last trainee day, which people sometimes get stuck in. It could take you months to get that last day. So they gave me the last day that ended the day after my birthday, which was great. I just remember also just how nice everybody was. I mean, I never had, I mean, I know you're looking at me going, I'm not just saying this, but after all these years. But you know,
40 years,
no, I'm telling you, you know, I'm telling you, after 40 years of who I've worked with, some people, it's like, you guys were really amazing. This is going mad.
40 years of
no, you guys are amazing, and it was a great project to work, like the last project to work on, and just because it was a big effects thing, it's given me building blocks that I still use, and I mean, the next thing I'm working on is going to be a big special effects project, and, you know, I'm going to get on the phone tomorrow and say, hey, we got to start storyboarding or we're going to be in trouble, you know, and I wouldn't have known that had it not been for Tron.
Yeah, can't tell her nothing.
Donald, you go next.
For me, the interesting thing about Tron is how it affected the social and historical and the present future of where we are today. The electronic world in Tron became the metaverse. Characters in the electronic world became avatars. In 1982, there was a guy named Hal Finney who worked on the Tron video game, and he was the first recipient of Bitcoin, and he probably worked under a Japanese pseudonym, and so he actually created Bitcoin. So there's several incidences like this. There's in Tron, there's the mainframe computer versus the personal computer, which is prophetic in the sense that it showed what Web3 is today, and that the community is part of the future. So these are the things that I think of. As obviously the computer animation became a staple in Pixar and live action films. But these are the things that foretold the future of Tron.
And you're working on a metaverse project now, correct? You were telling me?
Yes, it's called Cryptosaurs.ai, and it's about, in the not too distant future, we imagine dinosaurs come back to the planet to help mankind deal with the environment and with each other and not become extinct the way they did.
Wow. Nice. Cryptosaurs. Sounds good.
Cryptosaurs.ai.
Everybody remember that? Just plug it into your phone right now. Bruce, memory of Tron.
Well, there's so many of them. I do want to bring up one that is not with us here anymore, and that is David Warner. I was hoping, you know, he's going to make this event. A man that was totally inspiring. I answer that question, Mike, is that the friendships I made in this film, when you're doing sort of a pioneering effort, you're kind of all pulling together to try to pull this thing off, whatever department, all the way, you know, Carol certainly, and Donald Hines, and all of us added to that effort. That I believe is amazing because it is the science fiction that we're actually living, like you were explaining. We're actually living what this was. And look at video games today, everything. But for me, it was the friendships, certainly with Jeff. He still calls me Tronster, and I call him Flintster, and you know, and thank God he pulled out of the horror that he had just gone through with cancer and COVID. Yes. And so good to see him back on the screen again. And I want to thank Steven Lisberger too, along with Donald. Steven's genius. And this thing, I've done quite a bit of science fiction since. And I got my training to do Babylon 5 and other things. I literally got my training on on Tron. So I owe a great deal to this film. And there'll never be another one like it. I look around all the films that are made now, and there's no one that has captured that particular look, that world of the game grid yet. Even Tron Legacy, which was brilliant too. But this one is so unique.
So we want to finish on a note of looking forward. So a lot of this has been nostalgia, looking backward. So we're going to bring out Scott Drake from WDI, an executive at Imagineering, who's going to look into the future, the not-so-distant future, and give you a preview of what's going on down in Orlando.
Give it up for Scott, everybody.
I'm so excited to be here. I've just been backstage thanking every one of the panelists. I feel like I'm speaking for all designers when I say thank you. It's been such an inspiration for so many of us. And I also, you know, in design school, I think I studied Sid Mead more than anyone else. So I definitely love this film. I have one memory, maybe some of you guys will as well. An experiential memory from a long time ago of a Tron scene on the People Mover here at Disneyland. Yeah. Thank you. I had to recently look it up on YouTube just to make sure I wasn't making that up. It was pretty profound. But stepping back, in 2009, I was asked to be the creative director for an all-new Tomorrowland in Shanghai to an all-new audience. And as you can see here, we were searching for stories to tell, aesthetics. And it was about that time I was invited to come to the studio lot and see one of the next projects they were working on, Tron Legacy, and see some of their visual development. I gotta say, not only was I blown away, but instantly I went back to the drawing board and knew what I had to do. We had to immerse guests in the grid, and we had the opportunity to immerse guests in the grid like we never had before. Literally using all of Imagineering's tools and technologies to deliver something truly unique to Shanghai. But first, you know, we had to scan people into the world. So, you know, after the events of Tron Legacy, Sam Flynn's mind was open to the possibilities, and he wanted to invite all guests to come in and experience Tron, almost like a celebration, like the Olympics, bringing programs and users together. Programs may not have agreed with that, but that was his plan. And we wanted to scan people in and have the as much time in the grid as possible. And that's exactly what we did, is we scanned guests in the beginning of the queue to be in that, you know, stylized, mesmerizing, mysterious world of Tron and show that power surging. As we walk into the load station, it gives us previews of what's to come. There's a race view overhead showing us the game in front of us. But of course, we have to roll in the Tron light cycle. Woo! I consider this one of the most iconic vehicles of all time. I mean, it's up there with the Quinjet, but you know.
And Bruce's horse.
But this was something that not only is, it's one of the most sophisticated ride vehicles we've ever created. Delivering on that wish fulfillment of being able to pilot your own light cycle. Not only is it comfortable, it's beautiful, and it is fast. And when you get launched into the grid, face first, it is something that is truly exhilarating. It's a spectacle on board and off, and it's something you'll never forget. So I wanted to give you a sneak peek of Tron Light Cycle Power Run from Shanghai.
Thank you.
I gotta ride that thing. That's all there is to it.
It is unbelievable. Well, it turns out that Josh D'Amaro just announced earlier this morning that Tron Light Cycle Run is coming to Florida, Magic Kingdom, spring of 2023. Woo! Thank you for all of you who enjoyed it. And again, thank you, thank you. See you in Florida next year.
So let's bring out everybody from the Tron crew. I think they're backstage still. I think that's the idea, that we'll all be up here for one last photo. Gigi, you have anything to wrap up with?
Honestly, this has just been a dream come true for me personally. Just be up here talking about an iconic film such as Tron. I grew up on this movie, and then, didn't watch it for a number of years. But when I found out I was going to do this, I said, I have to go back into the movie. I have to relive things with these characters. I have to cry with these characters. I still feel some type of way about Ram. we need some more talk about Ram, but I just being on the stage with you guys is absolutely fantastic. To hear your love for this movie 40 years later, it truly warms my heart, and I'm glad to share it with other fans of Tron as well. Thank you for having me. Thank you for being here. It's really very nice.
Thank you for following us 40 years. Thank you for all of it, and it was a thing that attracted everyone in the world at that time that was interested in a particular kind of breakthrough film. And I think we've all, kept our eyes open for that kind of thing, as Bruce has said, ever since. Hasn't happened, but we have hope. So let's hope there's a Tron 3 out there.
Stay
out here. We're gonna party together. Bring the whole cast out.